I'd like to thank the Technology Development Coordination Center and especially the Scientific Outreach Team for organizing this forum and giving me the opportunity to advocate for 3D genome research. Each of our cell typically have about 2 meters or 6 feet of genomic DNA. And this length of DNA needs to be packaged and folded into a cell nucleus that's about 10 micron in diameter. Proportionally, this is equivalent to packaging the circumference, not the length, the circumference of Manhattan into a soccer ball. So this is a tremendously daunting task, yet our cells know how to do this and how to do this properly to ensure proper genomic functions. So the field of 3D genomics basically studies this three-dimensional folding organization of DNA. And in this talk, since it's largely for a public outreach, I'd like to actually give a historical overview of this whole field from the old days to the more recent milestones and advances and to the future. So first, the old days. I heard there are gonna be summer students here. So this is definitely before some of you or even I existed. So we know the DNA double helical structure was discovered in the 1950s, right? 2 decades later in 1974, Olins and Olins discovered these spheroid chromatin, see the cursor, right? Spheroid chromatin unit or bodies. So from later research, we know these are actually DNA wrapping around histones, and these are renamed nucleosome structures, these bodies. And this is the first level of packaging above the double helical structure of DNA. Then 10 years later in 1984 came the first sign of DNA looping. This was when people are studying bacterial gene expression. And they found for a gene cassette, there is this protein binding site on an operator called the RO2 that controls this gene cassette. However, unlike all the previous protein binding site or operator that were discovered, so this operator is very far away from the gene cassette, 280 base pair to be exact. So this is very far away back then because, you know, all the operator discovered back then were immediately next to the gene promoter or sometimes even overlapping with the gene promoter. So it was very baffling to people. How come, you know, protein binding to this sequence that's so far away from the gene can still regulate the gene expression? So the researchers did a very interesting experiment. They asked, what if we just insert even more DNA between the operator and the gene, just bringing them even further? In this figure, a light color stripe means the gene is repressed by the operator, and a darker color stripe means the gene is now expressing and the repression is gone. So you see that with zero insertion, just maintain the normal 280 base pair distance, there's a repression from this operator to the gene. If you insert 5 base pair, the repression is gone. If you insert 10 base pair, however, the repression is restored, the gene is no longer expressed again. So what's special about 5 base pair or 10 base pair? Double helical structure was known back then. People know that by turning increasing 5 base pair, you generate half a helical turn of the double helical structure of DNA, 180 degree turn. If you insert 10 base pair, you generate the full 360 turn of the DNA. So Professor Schlieff and his team basically proposed this DNA looping model, saying that there's a loop between the RO2 sequence and the promoter of the gene. Usually it forms a loop like this, and the protein that binds to the RO2 can repress the gene expression because in 3D, they are close to each other, forming a loop. And then when you insert 5 base pair in the loop region, you actually turn the DNA by 180 degree. Now the protein binding to the RO2 sequence is facing the wrong side. The loop is no longer there. Thus, the repression, the suppression of the gene expression is gone. And when you insert 10 base pair, however, the protein basically got turned back and the looping and the repression can be restored. All right. And 3 years after, the DNA looping is directly observed in both E. coli prokaryotes, yeah, E. coli this is, and also in eukaryotic cells, and especially mammalian cell in this case. So it's directly confirmed by electron microscopy again. And then what about larger scale? Particularly, people were wondering, you know, our individual chromosomes, we have 46 of them, during the interface of the cell cycle, how are they organized in the cell nucleus? You know, we know from textbook, you know, during mitosis or meiosis, and when cells are dividing, these chromosomes form this like rod-shaped structure. But during the interface, that is when a cell is not dividing, how are they positioned in the cell nucleus? There were two models. The chromosome territory model basically hypothesized that the individual chromosomes should occupy distinct nuclear space, and they don't intermingle too much during the interface of cell cycle. And then there's a spaghetti model that says each chromosome should just go spanning the whole size of the nucleus, and different chromosomes, they intermingle quite a bit, like just a mixed pool of spaghetti. And these are, by the way, not really chromosome pictures. These are models that people built with cotton thread, I think. And then in 1985, the debate between the two models basically came to an end with the direct observation of the chromosome territory. So here the researchers use a technique called in situ hybridization to label a single chromosome, and they find that the chromosome does not span the whole size of the nucleus. Instead, it occupies a distinct chromosome territory. And here I'd like to talk about this in situ hybridization technique. So in conventional DNA fluorescence in situ hybridization or DNA FISH, what people have are typically these oligonucleotide probes that are essentially also DNA. They have the complementary sequence to their genomic target. And these probes, they are fluorescent labeled with fluorescent dyes. And then upon heat denaturation, the genomic DNA is opened up, and these probes basically can bind to their genomic targets with base pairing. And then with fluorescence imaging, one can basically directly visualize these labeled genomic loci or even whole chromosomes. So with this technique, Professor Wendy Bickmore of UK and her team in 1999 showed that in the human cell, the chromosome 18 and 19, we know they're about the same size, yet they have very different localization inside of a nucleus. The GM poor chromosome 19 tends to localize at the nuclear periphery, whereas the GM rich chromosome 19 tends to localize to the nuclear interior. And this marks the first evidence to show that this higher order chromatin organization inside of the nucleus is not random and seem to be linked to gene activity. And then because different chromosomes occupy distinct nuclear territory, Professor Kramer and his team were able to just use a panel of combinations of fluorescent colors to label all the individual chromosome territories in the same single cell. And again, in this figure, you can see that, you know, chromosome 18 maybe is more closer to the nuclear periphery, whereas chromosome 19 is more close to the nuclear interior. So a quick summary, we have shown that using EM, people have discovered this nucleosome structure, right? And using some beautiful genetics work and later EM, people discovered DNA looping. And then using FISH, DNA FISH fluorescence imaging, people showed there are these chromosome territories at the other end of spectrum. So this roughly summarizes our understanding of the 3D genome 20 years ago. However, a huge question mark is here. So how, what's the level of organization that's between the DNA loop and the chromosome territory? It was a longstanding question that wasn't known back then. This brings us to the new days. So this is hopefully after all of us already exist. And then what's new in the past two decades is really, I think, the invention and applications of modern genomics techniques, especially high throughput sequencing in 3D genome research. And when talking about this period, one has to mention about this high throughput chromosome conformation capture technique, or HiC, invented by Professor Yop Decker and his team in UMass. So in HiC, contacting pieces of DNA regions, they are first cross-linked by just formaldehyde cross-linking, and the DNA are then cut with restriction enzyme. And then these cut terminals are ligated, and then these novel junctions are pulled down and sequenced. And through this pipeline, one can actually map contacting pieces of DNA across the whole genome. So it maps pairwise contact of all genomic regions in the whole genome. So this is really a powerful technique. And using the Hi-C technique, people found that at length scale of several hundred KB, there are these topologically associating domains or TADS structures, also known as contact domains. So these are basically continuous sections on the genome that are making a lot of self-contact. And within TAD, there are often chromatin loops, such as the promoter enhancer loops. In fact, the TAD structure often define the scope of a DNA looping. And then these TAD structures, they are further sorted into this A and B compartment organization, where compartment A is enriched with active chromatin, and the compartment B is enriched with inactive chromatin. Other sequencing techniques also showed that there are particular regions of the genome that are associated with nuclear laminar, and particular regions of genome that are associated with nucleolus. And these are termed laminar-associated domains, or LADs, or nucleolus-associated domains, or NADs. So this summarizes our understanding of the 3D genome about 10 years ago. And then there was still this key biological question that was haunting people for decades back then. That is, what is the exact 3D folding path of DNA at length scale and above the nucleosomes? Due to technical limitations up to 10 years ago, people actually don't know this question. So neither the imaging or the sequencing technique can really directly trace the folding conformation of DNA at length scale and above the nucleosomes. As a result, you know, from the TADs to the compartments to the chromosome territories, our understanding of the 3D genome organization at this higher length scale are largely bigger and bigger chromatin blobs. We call it blobology. We actually don't know how the DNA is really folded at this long range length scale. And to address this limitation, my lab and several other labs in the field are actually spearheading a new era of image-based 3D genomics. Particularly back in 2016, I led the development of the chromatin tracing technology. So this technique basically sequentially labels, pinpoint, and distinguishes numerous genomic regions along individual chromosomes in single cells, effectively super resolving the 3D folding paths of chromatin at length scales above the nucleosomes. And this is based on a highly multiplex version of DNA FISH. And Lacroix actually just talking about this technique actually in more detail, so I won't go into details here. And this chromatin tracing technology really enabled direct tracing of the 3D folding organization of DNA in single cells in situ. And since its introduction back in 2016, several labs in a list of beautiful works further expanded this technique to different genomic length scales, to different model organisms, and in combination with other modes of highly multiplex imaging, targeting, for example, RNA and protein. And my lab at Yale also continued to contribute to this field. So what's next, you ask? I actually asked ChatGPT the same question. You know, important questions in 3D genomics. Amazingly, the answers are quite accurate. When I first saw this, I was thinking, wow, okay. So we actually have either recent publications or ongoing research or grant applications that are addressing almost every single question here. For example, here it asks, how does the 3D organization of genome contribute to the development and progression of diseases such as cancer? How can we use 3D genomic information to develop new treatments and therapies? In one of our most recent work, it's on bioarchive right now and revised manuscript under review, we built the first ever single cell 3D genome atlas of any cancer using any technique, this with our chromatin tracing technology. And we showed that using this unprecedented data set, we actually can better call candidate cancer progression driver and suppressor genes, and also upstream regulators of the 3D genome alteration in cancer. And these are novel therapeutic targets. So exactly addressing these questions. And we have, you know, other works that are working, aiming, looking at aging, for example, looking at development. So overall, I guess the take-home message of this talk is, you know, these emerging new technologies, they are really opening up a new era of 3D genome research. And we believe that in the next step, not only we're going to get better insight into basic biology in development, aging, and diseases, and this new 3D genome information will guide the development of new therapies targeting diseases and aging as well. All right, finally, I'd like to thank my whole lab, and thank you all for joining this forum.